Good to be with you. Thank you. All sit down, relax. We're here tonight to talk to you about success. That's your decision for your success. Bertie and I signed up in this business November 1st, 1964. We were a couple young 25-year-old kids living on an alley in Rome, New York. The only thing we had going for us was a dream. It's the only thing. And you know, when you've got that dream and you go out and share it, that's when you start knowing whether you're a leader or you're going to limp home and cry. You know, you got to get rid of the loser's limp. Leaders lead. Winners win. And it's a choice. I get so sick and tired of hearing people talk about luck, luck, luck. That's a loser's excuse for a winner's energy, efforts, and commitment over a long period of time. It's an excuse, it's a cop-out. I'm not going to promise you anything in this business. Your sponsor can't promise you anything. This company can't promise you anything. Dexter and Bertie Yeager 25 years ago promised themselves something, and they had a plan they could achieve that promise on. We never gave up on our dream, and we never gave up on our promise. And when we promised other people we'd go out and work with them and help them, we always came through with that help. And it wasn't a matter of what happened to us. Success is that committed decision you're going to make it, regardless of the breaks. Because winners make their own breaks. You know, you have a choice. The attitude you carry is your decision. It's your decision as to whether you're going to have a winner's attitude or a loser's attitude. If you're going to get in this business or any other business of any other kind, the biggest thing you're going to have to deal with all your life is rejection. Rejection. There's always going to be somebody out there trying to tell you you shouldn't be doing what you're doing. That what you're doing won't work. That it's too early or it's too late. You know what I've noticed through the years? The excuses don't change. Just the faces. Just the faces. People always tell me about this place and that place. People are the same every place. You just got to find the hungry ones in the places you go to. When you find the lazy, the quitters, the negative people, we've either got to change them or they've got to change themselves, or we got to change the people we're talking to. It's that simple. Change is a part of life. That's a part that most people don't understand. Almost everything I've done all my life, I was the wrong guy at the wrong place at the wrong time, according to other people. But I always believed I was the right guy at the right place at the right time. You know, I don't look for the sharpest people in the world to sponsor in this business. I look for the hungry people, because a hungry guy can always pass a sharp guy. Hungry guys end up hiring sharp guys to work for him. That's very true. I remember when I've done a little bit of everything in our past. I remember when I was a young kid, I used to dream big. I dreamt someday I'd own my own construction company, Yeager Construction Company. I dreamt someday I'd have a bunch of apartment complexes. I dreamt someday I'd have some shopping centers. I dreamt someday I'd have some office spaces. And you know, I'll never forget. Bertie and I have always been tightwads. We've always watched our dollars. And you know, we got married We were a little bit shy of being 18. We were young kids, but we were ready, and that was 33 years ago. And you know, I believed you looked and found a girl you wanted to marry. You got that out of the way. And you start looking towards success. You know, so many kids today, they got to have all this fun before they start on the road to success. And then somewhere between fun and time to get ready to succeed, they got old. Now they're too old. I don't believe we're ever too old or we're ever too young. It's up to us as to what we want. Life is something that happens to most people while they're trying to find out what they're going to do. The problem with most people is that they expect life itself to take care of them. And you got to take care of your life. It is your life. I see some people get in this business and say, I'm not doing this for Amway. I'm not doing this for a Upline. Yeah, I didn't do it for Amway. I didn't do it for my Upline. I did it for my wife and kids. I did it my business. Someday you got to realize this is your business. And when it's your business and you start treating it and nourishing it like you do your favorite whatever, then it'll grow and it'll fly. Anybody can do it, but not everybody will. I have to laugh. For 25 years, I've heard about saturation, saturation, saturation. Took me a long time to realize when you got a little bitty mind, you believe saturation. When you realize how big the world is, and that there's new people coming of age every day, you realize we haven't gotten started yet. It'll never saturate, because there's always more people that'll say no than will say yes. The same guy that tells you about saturation says no. He proves his theory don't work, but he's too stupid to understand it. That's right. I don't care tonight what your dream is, but you gotta care, because you make the difference. And it's not whether you're 20 years old or 18 years old or 44 years old or 92 years old. It's what you've got stored up in here. Too many people try to separate all these separations. I have to laugh about all these different groups and all this different garbage going around. People are trying to make every kind of excuse in the world why people fail instead of giving them every reason in the world to succeed. You know, we talk about minorities. I get so sick and tired of hearing about the poor minorities. The minorities that wanted to do something about it are now called the rich. And they're a minority still. And they're every race and every religion and every background. But they never got hung up on the rejection that other people give you. I'm going to give you a little message for any of you that got a hang-up about any particular minority group. And that's real simple. People that normally succeed got their teeth kicked in so bad they did something about it. And when we stop kicking everybody's teeth in, they'll quit trying to perform. The majority of people that are highly successful in life came up and they were rejected in school. They didn't have the nicest clothes. I made sure my kids didn't have the nicest clothes when they went to school. I didn't want them to be the best dressed kids. If a little rejection helped me, a little rejection will help them. Sometimes we work so hard to make everybody acceptable, they don't feel any rejection. They're comfortable being broke. That's called middle class. Do you want to be at the top, the bottom, or in between? It's up to you. If you want to be on the top, you got to make a decision to be there. You got to go for it. You can't let anybody steal your dream. There's hardly anything that I've ever done that somebody didn't try to steal it. I remember when I first went, I was about 17 years old. I decided I want to be a car salesman. I always loved cars. So I went down to Chevy dealership, and the sales manager told me I couldn't sell cars. I was not a salesman. I had a little stuttering problem, and, you know, I just couldn't do it. So I accepted it. I accepted that rejection and went back to where I was working at Sears and said, well, I'm stuck here. But you know, a little while after that, I got married. And then I decided, well, I got to economize. I got a couple-year-old car. I'll sell that and get me a pickup truck, because when you were under 25, in those days, insurance was pretty high until you hit 25, and with a pickup truck, you could save money. So I decided to get the pickup truck. So I went out to the Ford garage to buy a pickup truck, and the sales manager said, aren't you the guy that sells lawnmowers and hardware and paint the electrical over at Sears? I said, yeah. He said, I want you to sell cars for me. And I went and told him how I couldn't sell cars because the Chevy dealer told me. And he said, Dexter, let me tell you something. Chevy dealer's out of business. We're still here. We were here before them and since them. They're gone. I hire salesmen. I train salesmen. I'm telling you, you can do it. That's good. But he was hitting hard on me, and I'm going like, oh, God, I don't know. So I said, well, let me talk it over with my wife. And that's a good cop-out. By the time I got home, we'd set up an appointment to have lunch the next day. By the time I got home, I walked in our apartment, three stories up. It was in a shack of an area, paying $25 a month rent. And that goes way back. Walked in the house, and I said, honey, guess what? I'm going to start selling cars. I made my decision up on the way home, but I needed time to think. I went and told, the next thing I went and I had lunch with the guy the next day. We set up a time. I did what was right. I said, I'll give you two weeks, I'll come to work. I went back, told the store manager at Sears, 2 weeks. I was quitting. He said, well, you're handling money in the cash register and everything, like I had been for 3 years. So if you're quitting, it's as of tonight. Oh, I'm shocked. I mean, I had never had that before. I heard you give people 2 weeks notice. So I'm through as of that night. I'm going like, oh, man, where am I? So I went, by lunch hour, I was a little nervous, and I guess I spilled my guts out to a couple of the older gals there, and they went in and jumped all over the boss. The boss called me in at 5 o'clock, offered me a raise. But I was smart enough at that point to realize I'd been asking for a raise for over a year. If this what I got to do is quit every time, what am I going to do when I'm 50? How many times can I quit? And when are they going to take me serious and say, yeah, that's it? So I realized somebody else controlled my life all the time I had a job. And in our life, I think some of the best things we can do for our kids. I remember back when I was a young kid and I had to get up every morning and trek through the snow to take my morning papers before I went to school. Did the paper route. I find out that most people that have a paper route learn money management. You learn, you only let people go so far, otherwise it's money out of your pocket. You only make a few pennies on each paper, but if they don't pay you, it is big bucks. So you gotta learn to be a businessman and manage money and pay bills, and you learn that early. I remember one of the first arguments we had after we got married. I remember the one we had before we got married. The one after we got married is one time when I came home, Bertie had all these little books out and envelopes, and she was gonna do our managing of our money. I said, I've been managing money all my life. Always made all my own money since I was 9, 10 years old. Never asked mom or dad for anything. I don't need somebody to manage the money now. I'm doing it. That was our first argument after we got married. First argument before we got married, was when her mother took us down and was showing us a nice bedroom set she wanted to make the down payment on for us to have, and we were going to make the payments. I said, I'm not starting off marriage with payments. I'd rather start off with junk than payments. But see, I was strong, and I've always been strong in what I believed in. And most of us are strong in our beliefs, but we need something to make them surface. And for a lot of you, you might seem like you're changing. You say, God, this isn't like me. But you're surfacing the beliefs that you've always had, and you have the chance to surface them through this business. Yeah, today is the first day of the rest of your life. You and I are just beginning. We're just beginning. Rejection, we've had it. I've had it just about every place that I went at some point along the line. It doesn't make any difference. The rejection you get, it's how you handle it. I remember if I'd asked some pretty girl when I was in school for a date, or if I go to the school dance and I ask a girl to dance and I get rejection, my immediate answer is I have to have victory. I got to go find somebody else to ask. I'm not counting no's, I'm only looking for yeses, so I went looking for a yes. I remember the time when the girls I was dating broke up with me before a dance. I said, I am not staying home like some of my buddies would. I'm going to that dance tonight. And I just started thinking, who does she look up to? Because that's the girl I'm going to take home. Because I learned long life. A lot of people hurt you and hurt you, and you're going to have hurts in life. But it's not how bad you get hurt. It's how you handle your hurts. You got to reach for the stars, not live on your scars. Are you living on your scars, 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 or are you reaching for a new star? I remember shortly after we got in this business, we went out and showed the plan to a lot of people, and some people would say, well, Dexter, you're a salesman, you can do it. And I tried to cover that with them, but I wasn't such a great fighter in that. I tell them, well, I'll help you, I'll do this, I'll do that. But when they were praising me a lot, it was hard for me to fight with them. But I'll tell you, the ones that said, you'll never make it, it won't work. Who'd want to get involved in that dumb thing? I'd smile and say, I'm going to do it. It's going to work. You know, I would not argue, get mad, or fight with a guy. I'm the type of person that gets mad later. On the way home, I'm the type of guy that would say, you'll eat them words, baby. You're going to eat them words. And that's the type of decision you got to make. You got to make winning decisions on your hurts. When we got involved in this business, a lot of people hurt us, a lot of people tried to hurt us, but I closed my mind to those hurts and looked at my dreams. In life, you're either looking at your dreams or looking at your hurts. And the more we look at our hurts, the more we hurt. The more we look at our dreams, the more people can look and see the stream as we go by. It's just that simple. Take the simplest thing. Give it your dream. Make it give you your drive. Make it give you your drive. I can look and look and look through the business. I remember I made direct. After I made direct in 60 days, after making direct, there was nobody. Nobody showed the meetings for us. I was shown the plan. I had to go out and start showing it the first time myself. I showed it every night, night after night. I was going on 1 or 2 hours sleep a night. And I'll never forget, after I made direct, there was nobody to give me any dream. And for 3 years, I floated. And after 3 years, I found my first books and my first tapes. And I found my first buddies. I made those guys that records and tapes that I could buy. I paid $25 and $30. 22 years ago for one little tape, maybe a Zig Ziglar tape, just one of them. And I know Zig was here earlier. Zig will be with me next week. Zig and I have become good friends. But I remember when I picked those tapes up and I thought, wow, I'd like to meet that guy someday. because I knew what I'd gained from some of his tapes. And I made him a personal friend of mine before I ever met him. And when I had my stroke 4 years ago, he was one of the first ones to call me in the hospital and tell me, hey, hang in there, guy. Hang in there, guy. You know, and I'll tell you something along the line in life. People are going to tell you, you work hard. And what's it worth? Is it worth all that material and all that other stuff? You're going for materialism, materialism, materialism. Your dreams may be materialistic, but God made the dreams. He made the materials. I prayed and prayed and prayed for months for a business opportunity. I asked God, help me have my own business. And this is the only thing that came by. I believe this was God's answer to my prayers. And I know so many people that pray and pray and pray, and we show them the business, and they're still praying, and they wonder why they're not getting an answer. They got it. They just rejected God's answer to them. I can tell you step by step through my life, if I had 3 days, all the rejection, but I don't live on the rejection. I live on the dreams and the success. The rejection's got to give you energy. It either defeats you or energizes you. I was talking to a girl just yesterday, young gal, probably 25 years old. She was telling me somebody had shown her the business, but she couldn't ever talk. She couldn't get up in front of a group. I said, sounds like my story. I skipped school so I wouldn't have to give an oral book report. I did one-to-ones. And then my upline director was going to come and do a meeting. I got all my people there and he didn't show up. And I talked to a couple other guys, and one of the other guys got up to do it, and he was bombing so bad. Thank God. I didn't realize it then, but fear deals with you. I had the fear. I couldn't get up in front and talk to 60 people. Are you kidding me? But then I heard him talk. I said, God, my 60 people are going to quit. I got to do something. And I went up and said, there's a phone call for you. Now, he was up doing a meeting. I walked up in front of the group and said, you got a phone call. And I took over. And I went on for 3 hours trying to retain what I put 60 days in the building. That's when I decided somebody had to do it, and it looked like it was me. I got in this business. Immediately I said, I'm going to go out and find 10 great guys. I can't do this, but I'll find 10 that can. And as I kept finding them that could, they didn't have as many guts as I did. They leaned on me and leaned on me and leaned on me. So I had to help them do it.
This is the end of side one. Please turn the cassette over for the continuation of this program.
Step by step, day by day, time by time. I remember back shortly after we moved to Charlotte in 69, we had our leaders and we were in a room, and I had a little rally, and we probably had 100 people there. And I said, my goal is to fill the Coliseum in Charlotte. They all laughed at me. They laughed at me. They thought I was crazy. And I was to them. But it was my dream. The ones that laughed at me weren't there with me when I filled it, because I had to replace them with other people. You understand that? Things have changed because we didn't quit. We didn't quit. We didn't quit. And we didn't quit. And that's the key for you. But you can't quit. won the mark of a millionaire. Did you think a millionaire before you're a millionaire? You think a millionaire before you're a millionaire. It doesn't matter whether you're a millionaire or a billionaire. You develop a habit and you live by those habits. You live by those habits. One of my important habits is prayer first. I pray to God to ask Him to help me in everything that I do. I wouldn't be out here tonight if I hadn't prayed, because I'm going to tell you something. 25 years and standing up in front of audiences time after time after time, the more you stand up, the more you realize each time there's thousands of lives just on the edge, not knowing where they're going to be. And you got a choice of saying the right thing or the wrong thing. And I don't know what their thoughts are, so I have to say, God, help me. You know them. Tell me what to say. Tell me what to say. The winner does different things than the loser. It's not what happens to you. It's how you handle it. 4 years ago, October, it'll be 4 years, I had my stroke. When they told me I'd be paralyzed, I'd never walk again. And you know, I'm here. I'm walking. I'm moving. Now, most people are going to tell you he's totally recovered. Well, he ain't. He is not recovered. He just found a way around it. Put a lot of prayer, a lot of effort, and you change to make up the difference. Most people say, you have no signs of a stroke. I said, that's right, because I'm left-handed now instead of right. If I was right-handed, you'd see it more. But when I decided to make my major side, my leading side, the left side, I had more to work with there than the crippled right side. So I put my emphasis on developing what I had. And I'm telling you, along the line, as you build this business, you got to find out what you got. And use what you got, not what you don't have. Reagan was known as a great leader and a great delegator. What you can't do, let somebody else do for you. Don't get all hung up on that. A lot of people say, I can't get up in front of a group and talk. I say, great. You bring the people to me, I'll do the plan. You can't get people, they can. It's a good partnership. They get the people, you do the plan. Then you find one other guy that he can get the people, but he can't do the plan, you do the plan. Guy says, well, I can't do it. I don't, well, go learn. If you can't do it, then get some people that'll get people and bring them to somebody that'll do the plan. You do whatever it takes. You have a partnership with your upline. We're all working together. Don't be ashamed of what you can't do. Live on what you can. And then you'll find that you can do what you couldn't do. The biggest reason that we don't think we can do something is because we lack confidence. It's like me, I didn't think I could get up in front and speak. When I had to, I did. Emergency, I came through. Whenever I show the plan to somebody, I leave a whiteboard and I say, here, and you don't have to go show the plan, but I want you to take my plan when I do it. I want you to listen to that tape and I want you to practice on this board just in case somebody comes to talk to you and I'm not there. The week before I'm coming in next time. Then you could show it in an emergency. But show it to your wife and kids, they're easy. And show it to all those guys that you know won't get in anyways. Practice on them. You get excited enough, you know what? Some of them get in. See, you got to look along the line. Let me tell you this, the way I figure it out, about 20% of the people that get in this business are what I call numbers people. Numbers people. Those are the type of people that are like me. I was broke for so many years, I counted every dollar I had. So when I was a young guy, I would check my wallet. I'd go into a men's room, check my wallet when I took a girl to the restaurant to make sure I had enough money, and then I'd be counting up and adding up on the menu what she was eating to make sure I had enough money to eat myself and leave a tip. I didn't want to be embarrassed. And so I was the type of guy that if I went to get groceries, I'd be running down and I'd be totaling up in my mind what the total would be so when I got the cash register, I was had enough money. Anybody relate to doing kinds of things like that? You're numbers people. You are numbers people. So when you sat there and saw the plan, you understood it. You comprehended it. But 80% of the people there are not numbers people. And they're buying the guy that's showing the plan if they get in. And so you gotta be sellable. You want to be lovable. You want to be strong. You want them to relate to you. If you just go put numbers on the board, ding, 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 I have a lot of people say, well, boy, I've shown the plan a lot, but I didn't get anybody in. It's because you didn't love them. You just showed them the numbers. You're getting your 20%, but you're missing the 80 because you're not reaching them. You're not giving them confidence. You're not telling them, I'll do whatever needs to be done. I'll help you. Help yourself. It's just that simple. Success. It's one step at a time. It's one dream at a time. I remember back when I had my stroke, not being able to make the first step. I remember having to have two nurses hold me while they were trying to make my leg move. I remember when they told me I'd never make it. I'd be in a wheelchair the rest of my life. I remember that well. I don't ever want to forget that. The difference between me and a lot of those other people that were sitting in there that had strokes that weren't as major as mine. I have people say all the time, well, you didn't have a major stroke then, did you? They told me I had permanent brain damage. 5 times they did the brain scan on me, permanent brain damage. We called everybody, every ministry, every place we could, and we prayed and prayed and prayed. The last brain scan they did, they couldn't find the damage. Faith handles things. I was not accepting a wheelchair. It's amazing. I'll go to doctors today and they'll say, well, are you out there running and exercising, jogging? Same guys that were asking me, you know, to pick my wheelchair. All of a sudden I couldn't do it. Now they wonder why I can't go farther. When they were telling me it was impossible to walk. So it's hard to give them answers as to, look, you don't understand how heavy this side is. You just ignore it and do what you can do. That's just as simple as it is. You gotta do what you want to do. You are what you picture yourself being. I did not picture myself being a lifetime cripple. Just that simple. Just that simple. I heard the story recently about this young boy that 11 years of age, they found out he had bone cancer in his leg. They were going to amputate his leg. The kid loved playing baseball. He was in Pop Warner and all the little things, and he fought and fought, and they let him keep his legs. And he got through high school, and he became the high school baseball star. And the Yankees came down to check him out. And he was scoring great. And he was a catcher. And as he was catching the ball, and this guy's coming for home, he goes to tag him out. And they banged heads. He got knocked out cold. They got him to the hospital and they told him he'd be paralyzed from the neck down for the rest of his life. He's 26 years old now. He's been through a few operations. He's not playing for the Yankees. But he is playing minor league baseball because he fought all the odds. He fought all the odds. He chose his destiny in spite of his challenges. I challenge you tonight to choose your destiny. Every one of us has got problems. There's nobody in the world without problems. Every leader is a leader because he's handled problems. The bigger leader he is, the more problems he's had. Don't tell me about, well, I got a kid that does this, does that. We raised 7 kids. I understand raising kids. Well, I got to go to my daughter's ballet and my son's baseball and this and that. Well, I didn't go to all that. Couldn't have paid for their ballet lessons if it was not working. My kids sort of understood that daddy's got to go out and do what he's got to do, and we're going to be kids and we got to do what we're going to do. But I made my kids earn their own cars, and I made them earn their own clothes and earn their own things. I gave them jobs to do, and I ain't paying them a lot of money. I didn't want to ruin my kids. I knew that if I paid them half what somebody else would pay them, if they ever went to work for somebody else, they'd work their heads off and they'd be great employees. I didn't want to overpay them and then have them go somebody else and have the guy look and say, you're gone. It's better they pay a price when they're young or they'll pay it when they're older. They learn how to work hard when they're young and they fill the products. They do this, they do that. They wash the cars, they wax the cars, mow the lawns, do everything that needs to be done. Help mom and dad. And you know, they grow up to be better adults. People that don't succeed have not learned to take on responsibility. And if you want your kids to be successful, oh, there's nothing wrong with a good college. But college is not going to make it for your kids. Their habits before they go there are going to determine their future. And you create those habits. Your strength and your teaching and your example. And yes, your performance. If we love our kids, we got a responsibility. I knew when I had that stroke, I was 46 years old, almost 47. And I knew when I had that stroke, if I let this stroke stop me, then I have just crippled 7 kids along with me. I've got to get out of here. I've got to prove to them that they can overcome anything because I'll be an example. And I'll do what I've got to do because I love my wife and my kids. And you're going to hear people talk about retirement, retirement. And it's great to be in a business where you can build a retirement. But you ought to love this business enough that you'd never want to retire from it. This is our social life. Man was put here to be productive, not to be a bum. When we close down and retire, our body starts shutting down along with it. Most people die within a couple years of retirement. Thank God I got a business I can work till I'm 90. Got a job where they're going to shut me down at 62, I might not make 65. They got a job where they shut me down at 65, I might not make 67. My odds go up when I got more purposes and causes beyond 65. We lengthen our life potential as we lengthen our causes. As we lengthen our causes. Back when I was 40, the doctors told me I wouldn't make 50. Well, December I'll be 51. Even with a stroke, I beat him out. I haven't believed the doctors in years. You can't. You just can't. If they give you negative stuff, you got to overcome it. I always look and say they're just protecting themselves so they don't get sued. They don't want to give tell you you can do something that they don't think you could. So I just go do it anyways. You got one life to live. It's yours. Nobody can live it for you, but you got to live it. And you got to enjoy it. And you got to love people. People is what life's all about, not things. I always get things so I can show people my love by letting them share some of those things and those dreams with me. People are always first in my life, not things. Things don't remember you. Things are only something you go for. And I tell you along the line, it doesn't matter what it is. You got to have a new, fresh dream all the time. Because I'm going to tell you, whatever you get, you got to go for it with all the gusto you can. You got to dream with all the dreams you can. You got to put all the energy you can. And when you get it, you got to say, okay, next dream coming up. You don't stop at any dream. Dream is just a step on the way to the world that you live in. To the causes and the drives, proving your capability more to yourself than anybody else. God made a miracle in you. But are you going to let the devil talk you into believing that you're trash? God don't make no garbage. He just makes good stuff. It's the devil that makes us believe it's garbage. Folks, your future's in your hands tonight. You can do whatever you want to do. Don't tell me how long you sat on something. We made Directing 60 Days and sat on it for 3 years. Because nobody was telling us how to dream. We had no help. We had to do it all ourselves. And when we started dreaming and started going for goals, then after 5.5 years in this business, we were double diamonds, including the 3 years and including everything else. So we made up for lost time. Bertie and I made Crown 10 years ago. 10 years ago. So we had broke over 21 directs in our first 15 years in the business. And down through those, at the same point, we helped a lot of other people that weren't in our organization go direct. And we helped thousands of other people make direct, not in our group, and thousands of people in depth. But we never got hung up on who was going to pass us or who was here or who was there. Every time I showed the plan, I always drew, this is me, the little short, fat, transplanted Yankee. This line is a line between us. It's a line of communication. It's a line of help. It's a line of love. This is you. You can become bigger than me. But I'll guarantee you'll have your tongue hanging out when you go by. And you will. And I'll tell you that tonight. You can all pass me, and I want you to. But baby, you'll have your tongue hanging out when you go by. And one of the biggest problems you're going to deal with is rejection and complacency. It's a double-headed challenge. Can't handle the rejection. Oh, I'm getting too rich. Why should I work harder? Can't handle the rejection. Oh, I'm getting too rich. Those are the two challenges. People ask me all the time, why is this guy leveled out here? Why did this guy not go any further? If the business is so good, this guy is sharp. How come he isn't any bigger? He isn't hungry enough to be any bigger. He may think he is, but he isn't. Give him time to grow. We all grow differently. Don't compare yourself with anybody else. God made you one of a kind. Be the best kind and the kindest best that you can be. I love you. God bless you. Do it to it.